I have limit as n goes to infinity. All right, the top one, 2 times 6 times 10 times dot, 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 times 4n minus 2 times 4n plus 2 over 5 times 8 times 11 times dot, 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 3n plus 2, 3n plus 5. So that's just your top fraction. And now this flipped. So the 5 times 8 times 11 times dot, 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 and I stop at 3n plus 2. And then over 2 times 6 times 10 times dot, 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 stop at 4n minus 2. All right, and I think now you can see all the canceling. Everything starts to go away. 2, 2, 6, 6, 10, 10, dot, 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 right? Stop here, stop there, right? I can't cancel this one out. There's nothing over here. And then the 5, 8, 11, the dot, dot, dot stuff, and then that one goes away. So all that's left is that. So we get limit, n goes to infinity, absolute value, 4n plus 2 over 3n plus 5. L'Hopital, one time, 4/3, which is bigger than 1. It diverges. Therefore, the series diverges. The limit of this ratio test was bigger than 1. Kind of strange, huh? Yeah. All right, another test. Now, this next test isn't used very often, but it's good to have, right? It's kind of like a, let me see, what's in my toolbox that I don't use very often, but it's good to have? What tool is good to have in your toolbox, even though you don't use it very much? What? A hammer.
Tire iron.
Tire iron. You know what I find to be useful to have in a toolbox that you don't need very often but it's useful to have? Is a set of little jeweler screwdrivers. You know those little small screwdrivers? It's always good to have like a set of those in your car somewhere. You never know. Need a small screwdriver for something. So this test is kind of like our little small set of screwdrivers. You don't need it often, but damn, it's good to have it when you need it, right? Okay, it's called the root test. And the root test is used when you see things that are raised to the power n. But when I say that, I mean like the entire formula is to the n. So here's what it says. Let's say you have a series. Given any series, could be alternating, couldn't, you know, it doesn't matter. If we take the limit of the absolute value of this series, but not just that, we actually come in and take the nth root. Okay, that's why they call it the root test. We're going to take the nth root of the absolute value of that formula and get an answer. And the conclusion of this is identical to the ratio test. If the L's less than 1, we get convergence. If L is greater than 1, we get divergence. And if L equals 1, it fails. So the good news is you don't have to remember anything new in terms of what the limit tells you. It's just the test itself is different. So here's an example of the root test in action. How about the limit? Oh, no, the limit. We're not doing a limit. We're doing a sum. Sum, n equals 1 to infinity, of 4n minus 3 over 7n plus 1, all raised to the 3n. Now, could we use ratio test here? Sure, we could. We could do it. The problem we're going to run into if we try ratio test is, remember, you have to do a sub n plus 1 over a sub n? When you do a sub n plus 1, you replace that with n plus 1, but you replace this with n plus 1 and this with n plus 1, and things don't cancel out nicely the way they do with factorials and the way they do with things raised to powers. So you start to get into a little bit of an algebraic mess. But since it's all raised to some power, and that power has an n in it, I start thinking root test. So what I'm going to do now is run the test. And I'm going to take the limit as n goes to infinity of the nth root of the absolute value of 4n minus 3 over 7n plus 1 to the 3n, right? To the 3n? So watch the way I do this. To the third, to the n. That's an absolute value right there. Isn't that the same? X to the 3n is the same as x to the third to the n. Because you multiply these two together, 3 times n, 3n. So what I did is I just raised this whole thing to the third, then raised that whole thing to the n. And why did I do that? What's the nth root of something to the nth power? They just kind of wash each other out, don't they? So this nth root here, like this nth root, all that is going to kill off that n. And all you're left with is whatever's still in there. Okay, so what's in here? See, limit n goes to infinity of the absolute value. I still have 4n minus 3 over 7n plus 1, but then raised to the third. And let's just run a quick limit on that. We can move the limit inside the cubed and just figure out what's happening here. So infinity over infinity. L'Hopital once. 4/7. So this is really headed towards 4/7 cubed. And 4/7 cubed is still smaller than 1, right? Remember, if you take a number that's smaller than 1 and raise it to a power, it gets smaller. It actually gets smaller. So this will definitely be smaller than 1. That converges. All right, that's it for root test. All right, we're not going to do any more of those. So your homework for this section page 463 3 through 11, page 463. 3 through 11 odds. On 9 and 11, just show convergence. Don't worry about trying to estimate it. They ask you to estimate how many terms of the series do you need in order to figure out the sum within a certain precision. Just run a test on those and see if you can show it converges, all right? And then numbers 19 through 39 odds. Feel free to try the evens. Okay. What time is it? All right, we have an hour, and we are actually going to start 8:05 now. So I'm officially kind of caught up now. We were supposed to start, I'm not caught up, we're at least on the same day we're supposed to be on. I'm supposed to start power series today, so. Right? So power series, what's that? I'm ahead?
Yeah, my brother just started polyons.
Just did what? Just started volumes? Oh, well. You mean here?
No,
Okay. That doesn't surprise me. Power series. Some preliminary things, okay? Some preliminary things. Prelim stuff, all right? If I say the absolute value of something is less than 4, what this means is that x must be between negative 4 and positive 4. On a number line, here's what I'm saying. If this is 0, and this is 4, and this is negative 4, your x must lie somewhere between, not including 4, and not including negative 4. So when we see an absolute value, if we're ever asked to kind of explain what this restriction means, what we do is we drop the absolute value, okay? So you would just drop the absolute value, put an inequality on this side, put negative 4 on this side. That's the way we handle the absolute value, okay? I'll give you another example. If I tell you the absolute value of x minus 3 is less than 2, how can I write that without the absolute value? X minus 3, right? Minus 2. This side? Negative 2 here, okay? Now, one more step. Let's get x by itself. So to get x by itself, I need to add 3 here, right? Add 3 here, add 3 here, add 3 here. And what would you get? This plus 3, 1, x less than 5. So on a number line, what we're saying is that x must be between 1 and 5. So the stuff in here, right, not including 5, not including 1. Understand that? One more. 2x minus 7 less than 1. Absolute value, 2x minus 7 less than 1. Means 2x minus 7 must be less than 1, but also greater than negative 1. Add 7. 6 less than 2x less than 8. Divide by 2, 3 less than x less than 4. X is between 3 and 4. All right? That okay? All right, we'll need that. Next thing, this is going to seem completely off topic. Domains of functions. So let's say I give you a function f of x equals x squared. What's the domain of that function? All real numbers, right? You would tell me, oh, the domain of this is all real numbers. Maybe you'd say like negative infinity to infinity. X can come from anywhere, right? Take any number out of that interval and I'm good to go. If I give you something like this, f of x equals 1 over x, you would say domain is everything except 0, right? So you could write maybe x is not 0, or in interval notation, you would write it like this. You'd use that little union symbol. So everything to the left of 0, everything to the right of 0, not including 0. And one more. F of x equals root x. Got to be bigger than, well, you can be 0 though, right? Because root 0 is okay? 0 to infinity, so I use a bracket instead of a parenthesis on the 0. But let's even think about this a little more in more basic terms. When we try and define a function, every time we've tried to define a function and give you some formula for that function, the domain is the values of x that you can plug in for which you will get an answer that makes sense. So like if I say that the domain of this is all real numbers, that means if I plug in any number, I'm going to get a numerical answer that makes sense. So if I plug in 2, I'm going to get 4, right? If I plug in 0, I'm going to get 0. Here, I plug in anything but 0, and I'm okay. Plug in 2, I get a half. Plug in 5, I get 1/5, right? Plug in 0, I can't do that. This one, same thing, right? Okay. Now, let's talk about power series. a power series is what we call an infinite polynomial. An infinite polynomial. And it looks like this. C sub 0, which is a constant, and I'll express this later, plus C sub 1 times x, plus C sub 2 times x squared, plus C sub 3 times x cubed, plus C sub 4 times x to the fourth, plus dot, dot, dot. You see the pattern here? Now, any time that we've written down polynomials in the past, example, ax squared plus bx plus c, that is a polynomial, right? We would normally write in what's called descending order, which was highest power of x down, right? And we would represent the numbers in front but with letters, a, b, and c. But because this is an infinite polynomial, I can't do descending order because the highest power of x doesn't exist. It goes to infinity, so I can't do it. So I'm doing it backwards order. I'm starting with the constant first, and the reason I'm not using a, b, c, d, e, f, g, right, is because I only have 26 letters. So I'm going to use subscripts on these c's instead, and I'll never run out of them, right? So c sub 0 is a constant, c sub 1 is a constant, c sub 2 is a constant. So I can put over here c sub n are constants. But not always the same constant. In other words, this could be 1 plus 2x plus 5x squared minus 10x cubed, right? Those constants may vary. That is a power series, all right? Now, you are allowed to rewrite that power series in sigma notation. And if you write it in sigma notation, here's how we write it. N will start at 0. Please note, for power series, we start our series at 0. This is going to go from 0 to infinity. It's going to be C sub N x to the N. So let's try it. Let's fix an x, all right? In other words, let's just imagine that x is some number, all right? Then if I do this and I plug in 0, then I'm going to get x to the 0, which should be 1, right? Times c sub 0, x to the 0, right? I'll do it that way. Plus c sub 1, x to the 1. Plus c sub 2, x to the 2. Right, do you see how this just generates this? Now, we do have a problem. There is an issue here. I'm wondering if anyone can notice where this formula might break down. Think about the x. What x would mess this notation up? If x is what? 0, good. If x is 0, what happens to this formula? You start out, right, imagine that that's a 0, and you start the formula out, n is 0. So you have 0 to the 0 is your first one. What's 0 to the 0? Well, in a limit, right, when we do limits, 0 to the 0 is what we call an indeterminate form. So is 0 over 0. Those are called indeterminate forms when you're talking about limits. But if I just ask everyone right now, hey, take the number 0 divided by 0, your answer should be undefined. So in a limit, it's called indeterminate. When you're just plugging in the number 0 over the number 0, it's undefined. So 0 to the 0, the exact number 0 raised to the exact number 0 is undefined. So the formula would break down, all right? So this formula is valid. This is a valid formula so long as x is not 0. All right? As long as x is not 0, this formula is okay. So what if x is 0? We'll just go up here. What would your answer be if x is 0? C sub 0, wouldn't it be? If x is 0, then it's no longer an infinite polynomial, is it? It's just this number. It would just be a constant. So x equals 0 is kind of the boring case. But we need to make sure we're aware of that, okay? All right. Now, that's what a power series looks like. It's an infinite polynomial. Now time for your first example.